You're listening to KAOR, Vermilion, South Dakota.
The opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of this station, the USD Department of Media and Journalism, or the University of South Dakota.
The CharCole Sports Show, the hottest names and the hottest takes.
Tune in every Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m. where Charlie Prien and Cole Larsch highlight prep sports, college sports, Coyote athletics, and professional sports. We would love to hear your questions for us, too. The phone lines are always open.
Tune in to the CharCole Sports Show each Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m. to hear the hottest takes on KAOR Vermilion.
Good evening, everyone. It's the CharCole Sports Show, Wednesday, April the 17th, 2024. Thanks for tuning in. Big show, so buckle up. First, we've got a USD recap of all sorts. We got a track recap from last weekend, a softball recap from the weekend, as well as the tennis team has made the Summit League tournament. They got a good chance to win it all. After that, we're going to move on to the SDHSAA football schedules, as those were released a couple days ago. Then right at 8:30 sharp, or as close as we can get to it, because you know how we are, we're going to do another draft segment. This time it's going to be the top five jersey combos in the NFL of all time, with a couple special guests as well for that one. Four picks per round. We're going to have 20 picks in that draft of the jersey combos. As always, we end with our picks of the week. Feel free to call in at any time, 605-658-6813, as we will always answer the phone. Buckle in, because the CharCole Sports Show starts right now.
Welcome into the 28th edition of the CharCole Sports Show. I'm Charlie Prien, joined by Cole Larson.
Yes, sir.
I think this show, Cole, of all of the shows we've ever done, you know, in our promo we talk about the hottest names and the hottest takes. I think we're going to have some really hot takes in this one.
I think so, too. I think that's just the way it's going to go, honestly.
So we're really living up to our name here. But looking
about
forward.
About time. You know what? About time we have some hot takes and some hot names on this show.
We're not engagement farming. We're actually giving you, you know.
We can change that really quick.
We could, for sure. I don't know. My mic's a little stiff over here, but I can make it work. But, the 28th edition of the CharCole Sports Show coming at you here. And this is the second-to-last show here in the KAOR studio.
We think. We're almost positive.
Well, I'm not going to be back Wednesday.
Yeah. So. Yeah, right. Third, maybe, most likely seconds. We got one show after this, I think.
And wow. I know, that's nuts, man. Next week's show is going to be fun. I don't know what we can do. Have a couple ideas in mind. We can talk about that in the meantime. Cole, we have some really exciting news to bring forward today. We've spoken about it a little bit in the past, but we've really been working on it as of late. We are putting together a awesome NFL draft show. It's going to be a live show on our YouTube channel. And it's going to be fabulous. I think we got a ton of graphics ready to go. We have a module ready to go, and I think it's going to be awesome, Cole. I'm really looking forward to that. We're going to have some guests on the show as well, but it's going to be a
one of the possible guests just walked by, actually.
Good. We're hoping to have some people on. We're going to have four headsets, so hopefully we get some people on, and we have some great ideas we're gonna run at you. A live NFL draft show broadcasted on YouTube. Cole, really looking forward to that. Kind of give me or give the audience your thoughts on that ahead of our show and the content of this actual show.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a fun time because, you know, we're just going to sit around. And we've actually done this before, you know, but it was just us with a couple notepads in front of my TV in my basement.
Right.
We just sat there and talked to each other about the draft picks. I have that little notepad somewhere where I wrote down every single pick.
I know.
I'm not going to do that this year, though, because it's all going to be on my computer in front of me, hopefully. But, it should be fun. We're going to sit down. We're going to talk a lot of football. So, and again, if you just want to hear our voices, then you can tune into that. That's a week from tomorrow. Draft starts at supposed to start at 7. We're probably going to get on about 6:45. Probably more like that. Maybe the Bears fan, Tavin Carncrass, who's been walking back and forth about 6 times in the last 2 minutes, maybe he hears this as a bat signal. We'll talk to him after the show. But, yeah, it should be fun. See what we can get lined up. And you know what? If it's just us two talking the draft, we've done that 100 times anyway, so why not do it again?
I know. It'd be awesome. It'd be a great time to do something like that, Cole. We could take phone calls even, too, while this is happening.
I didn't even think about that. We could. And it's not FCC regulated, so we can say whatever we want.
Right. I think we'll still keep it pretty kid-friendly.
Well, yeah, it'll be.
But we're not going to. I mean, so if you want to really get out there, you sure can. But, no, it should be a fun show. We are really hoping to plug and promote that. We will have some graphics put out here at some point. We'll have a YouTube stream created so we can start sharing that link. We're hoping to multicast it to both Facebook and YouTube, correct, Cole?
We can try that, yeah.
That'd be cool. And really get some. What do we have? We have a Facebook account, you know?
The show does not. We individually do. The stream is created, by the way.
Oh, it is? Okay. I'm going to go look at that.
Yeah, if you look up CharCole Pod on YouTube, it is created. It's called the CharCole Sports NFL Draft Watch Party.
Yeah, we should give folks our actual. What? No, our actual YouTube handle. There we go. There it is.
That's what it is. Yeah, or you can look up any of these shows by just looking up the CharCole Sports Show. Now, it's going to be hard because once it searches, it's going to show results for CHARCOAL. That's not us. It is CHARCOLE. If you look at that, we've got every single show that we've uploaded to this point on YouTube as well.
There's,
of course, just the audio, and then there is the draft watch party that is up and ready to roll.
Yeah, we have some of our best work on here as well. Our first ever state amateur baseball preview, which was CharCole episode 31 of our original podcast, Cole. That was uploaded almost 2 years ago.
Which is insane.
But if you scroll back to our first ever podcast, we have our 6th podcast on here. I know that our podcast exists out there. We've spoken about that as well.
Yeah, it's somewhere in the ether.
But 4 years ago is when we posted our first podcast on the show. And where we've gone from then, we always recorded the podcast on a Friday. This is when we had to. And yeah.
You know, for episode 30, and depending on if we can get this streamed next year, you know, live and try and find it, we dressed up in dress shirts and ties for our 15th episode.
Oh, my.
You remember that?
We did.
We did that, yeah. We did. Other than that, we wore just about the same thing every episode, but.
Football jersey. We had Hunter Pranger on. What time was a special guest? Who else did we have on for special guests?
Oh, gosh. We had all kinds of
people. We had like little drop-ins of people.
Yeah.
And I know Dawson Gerlach had some time. Reed Russ had some time. I think we wanted to have Mr. Olson on at some point, too.
Right.
But I don't know if that ever happened. But now it's just our audio files. So.
Yep.
Dah.
Yeah, unreal.
But, yeah, look where we've came. And we're looking forward to next Thursday, Cole. 6:50-ish, 6:45, you know, Cole.
Yeah, somewhere
that
are,
you mentioned
yeah,
that
right.
It starts at 7, but really the first pick probably won't be till 7:15, 7:20.
Probably, because they're going to get all their last-second analysis in, and just for the Bears to take Caleb Williams. But you never know.
But then that's where it gets fun after that. I mean,
right, then anything can happen after that. And hopefully we see Vikings draft pick at about 7:45.
Yeah,
that'd be sweet.
If you're looking forward to seeing our reactions. Because, yeah, as you mentioned, about 7:45, because
hopefully
the first few picks take so long because they do such a big analysis and coverage of the first few picks, and then it speeds up towards the end. We'll have our reactions and much more next Thursday, plus some special guests on our show. Tune in. We'll have it on our YouTube channel. Not here, unfortunately. We'll have it on our YouTube channel, and we'll stream it. Cole, I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, we will, and we'll push that link out. If you have either of us on Facebook, our Twitter account, both of our Twitter accounts and the show's Twitter account, we'll get that out there. I mean, technically, I could tweet it out now, but we got a show to do. Speaking of the show, we should probably get to it, huh?
Yeah, I'd say. We're
all right. Well,
look at us.
Let's yeah, of course. We started the 6 o'clock segment at 6:10. If you want me to, I can breeze through all of this because I was at this track meet and watched the article get written right beside me as I was the public address announcer on Saturday.
Yeah, you were. I'll let you breeze through that, and then I can kind of talk about softball since the last time we spoke.
Yeah, they just had a triple header there. We'll take or a weekend series. But yeah, track, the women's 4x100 meter relay broke the South Dakota school record, and they also won 21 events on Saturday. The women's 4x1, Aaron Kinney, J.C. Pulse, Avery Schmeichel, and Sarah Reifenrath broke the school record, 44.39. It's 23rd in the NCAA. Joe Lynch, high jumper, cleared a personal record height of 7 feet and a half inch to win the high jump. Leads the Summit League and ranks 15th in the NCAA. Marshall Farreau vaulted a season-high best of 17.8.5 to move to 10th in the nation. What in the world? You know what? I'm going to mute you for a second.
Not a bad idea.
And you just keep doing whatever there. Carson Stair leaped a personal best 50 feet 6.75 to win the men's triple jump. That's also a Lily Bridge track complex record. He's second in USD program history and ranks 24th in the nation. Aaron Kinney opened up the 100-meter dash by winning it in 11.31, moves her to 27th in the nation.
As she does.
Yeah, as she does. It's 300ths off her school record in the event. I just got it. Okay, you got it over there.
Fixed it.
Reifenrath crossed the record finish line in the 400-meter dash, 53.28 seconds, missing her school record time by 600ths. Now, that was cruising, and she really wanted it. She was laying there on the track for a good solid couple minutes. I mean, she's gassed. Meredith Clark launched a shot put, a personal best 52 feet 8 inches, second in USD history, 41st in the NCAA. Avery Schmeichel won the 100-meter hurdles in 13.68 seconds, second in the Summit League. Bennett Schwinn on the men's side captured the long jump, 25 feet 1.25 inch, and he's just a sophomore. That's his personal best. Lauren Meyer took first in the women's triple jump, 40 feet 3.25, ties for the Summit League. And then they had a bunch of alumni, whatever you want to call them, unattached and attached, both. They had a bunch of them win as well. The men's 4x1 won in a winning time of 40.76 seconds. Adigbite won the open 100 in 10.49. So that moves them to 7th. In the Summit League, I don't know what's going on in this group chat. I'm going to have to mute him here in a second. Redshirt sophomore Tristan Gray, who just had an article, wrote about him. They were the featured story this week. Won the men's shot put with a season best 55 feet 7.5. Men's and women's, they swept the 800 meter. Men, Alexander Ware won it in 154.38, and senior Madison Yoakum on the women's side won the 800 in 216.82. The women's 4x4 capped off the running events by winning the event 349.63. That was cruising. Unattached, Lydia Knapp won the discus 166 feet 7 inches. And let's see. Next trip is to the annual trip to California next weekend for the Mount SAC Relays. That'll begin Thursday in Walnut, California. So 21 event wins and a couple records broken, Charlie.
Yeah, we took care of business as we do, and I think we can come away pretty happy with this weekend's results, Cole. And I think looking forward, you know, this meet is going to build a strong base for us. Got some serious Summit League action coming up, though, and I think that moving forward, we are pretty excited about what we got as a program. Obviously, the reigning indoor champions looking to capture some outdoor stuff here. One thing I will note, Cole, now, before we get to later shows, is that this year, the Summit League championships in the outdoor division are in Minnesota, and they take place at St. Thomas. Now, I don't know how that'll be, obviously, the weather and such, but a large part of our team points comes from our vaulters and our jumpers as well. Our field events is what I'm trying to say. Obviously, I don't want to discount our running events as we're really good there too. But the conditions have to be pretty darn nice. And we're hoping to get nice conditions up at the Summit League Championships and hopefully come away with a men's and women's outdoor Summit League championship. So that'd be good. Cole, you want to talk about softball here?
Oh, yeah, I can. They had a weekend series against a very good Omaha squad who I believe has only lost like 8 times all year.
We got them on the last one.
We did get them on the last one. We almost had them on Saturday and on Saturday as well. Took losses 3-0 and 5-2, and then a 5-run first inning in the game on Sunday opened things up, and they got the win 5-1.
That must have been a boring last couple innings.
Yeah, I mean, well, here's the deal. The first inning took 30 minutes, and the rest of the game took an hour and a half combined, so I was not complaining. I had a tee time to catch, although I would have loved to stay. I was getting paid by the hours, so, you know,
that's the stuff.
That's exactly what happens. 5-1. Omaha had a lot of chances. They're definitely, you could tell, they're a very good team. But they just came up short a lot of times. We got a lot of crucial outs with runners on second and runners on second and third as I'm trying to, why is it saying I have no internet? I have internet. Oh, my gosh. Anyway. But, yeah, went 1-2 in the weekend. Next up, they travel this weekend to St. Thomas.
Yeah, I think this is a huge meet, actually, Cole, just for the fact that, as I mentioned, we gotta have some wins in the series here, and there's not a lot of, I spoke about it in a previous show, but there's not a lot of games in this Summit League schedule, obviously.
Two weekends left,
There's not a lot of teams either, but.
That is true.
You have two more big series coming up here, then you're playing the Summit League Championship, those taking place in Brookings, and, you know, if you can find some wins here against St. Thomas, it'd be a big deal. Hopefully we can take that, take care of that, and then when we come home, we really have to capitalize on May 3rd and 4th. That is right after finals week. So that's kind of wrapping up how our softball season's going. Again, Cole, you mentioned 19-25. We're 4-7 in the Summit League, looking to get back on the winning streak. Got a one-game winning streak. We'll see if we can take that into St. Paul, Minnesota.
Yeah, St. Thomas is right above us in the conference standings. We're 4-7. They're 5-7. And the weekend after that, we take on NDSU. They currently sit second to last at 3-6. South Dakota State 11-0 in conference play. They would probably be 12-0 if they played that third game down here in Vermilion, because USD got no hit in the first game and they had one hit in the second. If I remember correctly,
is that so?
If I remember correctly. Now we're going to move on to tennis very quickly. The Summit League Tennis Championship kicks off on Friday in Waukee, Iowa. The women's tennis team, they are currently second, and the reason I bring this up
is there a school there?
Not a Summit League school, no.
Oh, okay. I was going to say.
I have no idea why it's at the Waukee Northwest High School Tennis Complex in Waukee, Iowa.
Fascinating.
Interesting.
I'll tell you a story about Waukee after we get off the show.
Women's semifinals, Denver 1, South Dakota 2, North Dakota 3, Oral Roberts 4. South Dakota faces North Dakota at noon on Friday. That's going to be on the Summit League Network. The reason I bring this up is South Dakota just beat North Dakota 6-1 in their home match on Friday. So
we're playing good.
Yeah, we are. I mean, they lost. Well, I think they technically lost twice, but only gave up 1 point. I'm not sure how the scoring all worked. I don't know if one of them just an exhibition or what, but as I was not there. But, yeah, then they will likely take on Denver, and that is a team where, let's see, I had it up here somewhere. We played Denver when they were, let's see if I can find it. That's going to be a tough one as we lost 6-1. So a team we beat 6-1 and a team we lost to 6-1 likely going to be our two opponents. Let's see if we can't get a Summit League championship here.
That'd be awesome.
For women's tennis.
How would you cover that, Cole?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
Something I've never done, and it seems like every time I watch it on ESPN, they just let it happen, and then they talk between the play, and then they just let it happen again.
Yeah.
That's probably what I'd do.
I suppose. Yeah, that's how it is professionally, too, I guess, now I'm thinking about it.
Right. So, yeah, that'll be – I don't know if there's going to be announcers or what, but – noon on Friday. That'll be streamed on the Summit League Network. The championship is Saturday at 10 a.m. Drake is technically the host of the Summit League tournament, of the Summit League championships. Anyway, shall we move on?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Actually,
I'm cooking something up here. Hold on.
Yeah, I'm trying to find the. Here's my old link. The South Dakota High School Activities Association, whether intentionally or unintentionally, released the full schedules. Was it yesterday? 2 days ago?
Yesterday.
Was it yesterday? They released the schedules in their entirety.
And somehow the first person to release it in the press was the radio guy from Huron.
Yeah, true.
I got a lot of respect for him, by the
absolutely.
Way.
Absolutely. Well, he's my boss's dad, so I got to have a lot of respect for him. Jeff Duff, he's been up there a long time. I think longer than we've been alive combined.
Oh, for sure. He's a two-time South Dakota Sports Broadcaster of the Year.
I don't know if he was just looking for it and just happened to find it, but yeah, he was the first person to release it. Yeah, that is true. So we're going to go over that. We got about 10 minutes to kill here. Charlie, there's a couple of them that stick out to me, and as I see a couple teams end their season with three away games.
Yeah. I will say this. I think the diversity of this year's schedule is better than any years past, Cole.
That is true.
I want to reiterate that before I get into anything else. I think a lot of teams got to see some new opponents this year, and I think it's going to make for a very balanced playoff or postseason. Yes?
Again, in the next 10 minutes or the rest of the show, at any time you want to call in your thoughts here, 605-658-6813. Sorry to cut you off there.
No, you're good. I'm glad you did cut me off. But yeah, okay, let's kind of get into it here. I don't have much to say about AAA and AA. I think that when I did look at AA schedules, they didn't go into 11A this year as much as I thought they would. And I think that's interesting. But you also have to take into account that I did think that there was a chance, and this is saying that all the alignments are set too, and information as of recent just came out that teams are still trying to consolidate and getting approved by the SDHSAA, so that's going to make this whole thing hairy.
Well, there was a board of directors meeting today, and I believe they approved the second hearing for everything.
Yeah.
So I don't know if they still have to vote on it or what.
But taking a look at like 11A schedules, they don't play any 11AA, and I think that'll make for a more balanced playoff there and a lot less complainers as well when it comes to seed points.
Yeah, you'd think so.
So I think that's a big step there in the right direction as far as postseason implications. And then scrolling down the list, talking about 11B here first, Cole, I really don't have much to say unless you do about anything between 11AAA and 11A.
No.
Just because.
Not really.
Because everything's so set in stone and everybody plays each other essentially.
Yeah, pretty much.
I do want to say, though, with Rapid City Christian going up to 11A, their schedule is no cakewalk. You know, getting into the semis last year in 11B.
Right.
And losing. They play Canton. At Canton first game, then they go get or they're home against Sioux Falls Christian, then they get on the bus and go back to Del Rapids, then they're at home against Chamberlain, at home against Hot Springs, get on the bus and go to Lakota Tech. Pretty close game against Lee Deadwood, but if you think about a flip schedule next year, you're gonna have to go to Sioux Falls Christian, Chamberlain, Hot Springs, Custer, and Belfouche. That's not a terrible schedule, really.
Yeah, that seems pretty balanced home and away.
Yeah, so I think that's pretty solid, and it gets some diversity to the eastern side of the state as well. And then if you look at Sioux Falls Christian, obviously, and see who they play Bridgewater Emory Ethan, which I thought was really odd. Not odd, but just interesting, I guess.
Yeah.
And then you look who else Sioux Falls Christian plays, and, you know, their only out west team is Rapid City Christian. So where's the diversity fall off there? I don't know. But I think so far, we're going to get into 11B here in just a second. But it was pretty good through all of those classes.
Yeah, I thought so. I think exactly what, like you said, there wasn't really a whole lot that stood out because, you know, like you mentioned, a lot of the teams just kind of everybody plays each other, and that's just how it is.
And I would like to say I think Sioux Falls Christian wins 11A right now, next year.
Yeah, I do think
they got some dudes.
Yeah, they do.
So, anyways, 11B, we have some spectators. 11B, Roncalli, Baltic, I don't have much to say here. I think we'll take a look here at Chamberlain's schedule now coming down out of 11A.
Again.
They play Wagner first week and then get a bye in their second week, and then they have St. Thomas, Moore, Miller, Highmore, Harold, Rapid City, Christian, Mount Vernon, Plankington, Parker, Woonsocket, Weston, and Spring, Sanborn, Central, and Winter. I mean, Chamberlain's schedule is no cakewalk, but that's a pretty nice schedule coming out of 11A, considering where they were and how long they had to spend on the bus.
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly right. It's going to be a lot different for them, and they're going to be a lot closer road trips, you might say, even though they do go out to St. Thomas More and Rapid City Christian again. But other than that, they really don't go very far east, as you kind of saw last year.
Yeah, not at all. Scrolling down the list here, I don't have too much else to look at. I want to look at Elk Point Jefferson really quick, playing Parker, Mount Vernon, Plankington, Winter, Baltic, Beersford, Wagner, and Flandreau, and ending the season with Sioux Valley. Elk Point Jefferson's schedule is no cakewalk. They made these schedules on 11B very competitive this year, Cole.
Yeah, they did. I think that was kind of their goal, was to balance them out a little bit more. You know, sometimes you look at a team's schedule and they're like, okay, we're getting close to the playoffs. How did they get here? And you're like, oh, they played one team with a record higher than 500. And again, you can't predict that before the season, but usually you can get a decent guess. But I think they balanced them out pretty good. One thing I've always wondered, and maybe we could implement this, is why do we have bye weeks on the first week and the last week?
I don't know. I really wish they wouldn't do that.
Do you ever remember a time? I don't remember off the
top
of my head.
We had a bye second week in one of our school years.
Right, that was second week, and it still felt really early.
I know.
We also had one the second to last week, I'm pretty sure, and that felt really late.
I know. And
but why, imagine opening up your season, and it's opening weekend, and you're sitting at home because you don't have a game.
Terrible.
Or it's the last weekend, and you're fighting for a playoff spot, and all of a sudden you're like, I'm just sitting at home. There's nothing I can do.
Exactly, and then you're maybe either better off for it or worse off for it. It's like the bye week in the NFL. I do want to say right now, I think the toughest schedule in 11B football next year is Sioux Valley. They take on St. Thomas More, Baltic, Clark Willow Lake, Sisseton, Dual, Flandreau, Beersford, and Elk Point Jefferson. I think that's going to be a very tough schedule, Cole.
Yeah, it is. They're going to have their work cut out for them, but it seems like every year they always do, and they always come out somewhat on top.
We're going to move on to Class 9AA. You're going to have to scroll down a little bit, Cole. It's not in order on here, but we're going to start with 9AA. And they had to essentially try to throw out conferences if they could, but they tried to throw out conferences, if I want to reiterate, but they did not, and they kept the conference structure, which really made a lot of coaches and individuals in the school districts happy. But kind of looking at 9AA, I think a big name, and there's a couple big names here, actually. One of them being Freeman Marion, Freeman Academy. You know, they got some kids coming up here, Cole, but who do they play? Here's their schedule. They have Parkston, Bon Home, Elkton Lake, Benton, Gayville, Vallon, Alcester, Hudson, Centerville, Irene, Wakanda, and their conference crossover game to end the season.
Okay, I was wondering what that game was. It just says crossover. I'm like, what?
So they play, it's based off of records and such.
So basically like their conference championship almost?
Yes, essentially.
Something like that.
You can't play the same team twice, though. And
right, that makes sense.
And there's
basically just a blank game. It's like you're going to play someone in your conference this day.
And there's a chance that you could have five home games.
Interesting.
If the cookie can crumble the right way.
Huh, interesting.
But I think Marion Freeman Academy has a legitimate chance next year to win 5 to 6 games, and that'd be a huge step up for them. And there's one other one I wanted to look at, actually a couple. I want to look at the Hamlin schedule, the Hanson schedule, which is probably the biggest matchup in the history of 9AA's schedule this year. Parkston's schedule, in my opinion, is the toughest. Scotland Menno's the schedule I want to look at, because this is one I told you yesterday at the meeting. Here's Scotland Menno's schedule, Cole. Gregory, and they lost a lot of dudes. I think they win that, coming out of 11B.
Yep.
Corsi Stickney, I think they beat Corsi Stickney. It's going to be a tough game.
Yeah, it is.
But then you beat Bonhom by a bunch. Trip down Mount Armor, Andy, Central Dakota Christian. That's going to be their toughest game, but then you run over Burke, you run over Colomi, you run over Avon in your conference game at the end. You probably run them over too, because you're playing a bunch of people that are just not your skill level. I think Scotland Menno goes 7-1 next year.
I think that's honestly very, I think that's going to happen, honestly. The more you talk about it, the more I look at it, I'm like, I think so.
And look at TDA's schedule. It's similar, almost a mirrored schedule. They have Bonhomme, probably a win. Gregory, probably a win. Of course, Stickney, probably definitely a win. Nothing against Course Stickney. I have much respect for Waylon Bull and the running back core from Course Stickney. Scotland Menno is going to be their tough one. They run over Burke, run over Avon, maybe. Tough. They just won this championship last year coming out of 9A or 9B. They were 9B. But that's a conference game. And then they have Cologne and a crossover to end it.
Avon is still 9B, by the way.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Yeah. Looking at that, Cole, I don't have much else to say there. I think the toughest schedule, though, in 9AA is Parkston. Look at their schedule, man.
Yeah, but it always seems to kind of shake out that way, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, I suppose. Parkston has Freeman, Marion, Freeman Academy, who I think is going to be really good. Stanley County, who should be good. Kimball Whitelake, who should be pretty darn good. Hanson, who's going to be good. Bonhomme, who's going to be all right. They should beat them. Platt's going to be back, as they do. Woolsey Westington, which is pretty crazy that they get Woolsey Westington. That's a draw. And then they get Gregory to end the season. It's like, it's no cakewalk there.
Right. And you never know, once you get late in the season, like any of these teams that we think could go 9 or might go 7-1 are going to go 1-7 and vice versa.
One team I haven't looked at schedule-wise is Canastota. We got to get going here. Holy buckets. We'll be fine. We can move that Jersey thing along. But I'm going to look at Hanson's schedule real quick. Garrettson at Garrettson, then they go to Hamlin the week after, does Hanson. Then they have DeSmit, and then Parkston. You play, you know, a wide array of teams you don't usually play. Hamlin, DeSmit, and then you got Chester, Howard, Viberg, Hurley, and Canastota end the season. I want to look at Canastota's schedule. Let's move up to 9A, Cole. Let's look at Canastota's schedule right here. Again, Platt Geddes moved down to 9A. So that's a big step for them. Now, it's going to be a different 9A look next year. But,
Canastota's 9B.
Canastota's 9B. Holy buckets.
Yeah, they host Viberg Hurley. They travel to Coleman Egan, host Iroquois Lake Preston. They travel to Garrettson. They host Howard. They host Sioux Falls Lutheran. They got the bye. And they travel to Chester and travel to Hanson.
I think
that's a tough finish to the schedule right
that
there.
That is, but the beginning of your season, you're going to be building up like this. And then if you can get to a good point at the end of the season where you're healthy, you'll be in good shape.
That's a timely bye, too, right before those two games. Mm-hmm. You're going to need it.
Yes. They're pretty happy with their schedule. I think I'm going to take a look at Centerville's schedule quick here, and you can talk about Vermilion's if you want to as well. Next year for Centerville, they have Dubuque Area at home, then Alcester Hudson at Alcester, and then they're at home against Garrettson. I think that'll be a pretty tough game for Centerville. I don't know if we'll be able to squeak that one out. We'll see. And then we are at Del Rapids St. Mary's, at home against Irene Wakanda, at home against Freeman, Marion Freeman Academy, away against Gable Vallon, and your conference game is supposed to be away. Centerville's got to find a way to win 4 or 5 games next year to really get in. Do I think they can do it? I don't know. I think we're going to learn a lot about ourselves in the Dubuque game, because Dubuque's coming off of being a runner-up in 9A, Cole.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, and it's one of those deals where we can talk about all we want right now, but it's going to come down to the actual 8 games they play.
Indeed. Pretty much that's all I have to say for 9A. Anything on 9B?
I was kind of looking through things. Nothing really stuck out to me. It's just, again, the week 0 and week 8 buys I just don't get.
Mm.
But I feel like I'm going to be barking up a tree for a long time on that one.
The one thing I do want to look at is Sioux Falls Lutheran, Cole. I told you last night I think they could win 2-3 games next year. They have Irene Wakanda, Avon, Oldham, Ramona, Rutland. I think they beat them. I think they go close against Irene Wakanda. Anyways, then they have Arlington week 3. That's going to be tough. Coleman Egan, that's going to be tough. Canastota's going to be tough. They beat Gayville Vallon, and they'll have a close game against Del Rapids St. Mary. But I think you can win 2 games easily next year for Sioux Falls Lutheran.
Yeah, it's...
That'd be crazy for them.
Yeah, that'd be wild. Again, like I told you, like my response to you, if you would have told me that a while ago, that Sioux Falls Lutheran was A, going to have football, and B, going to win a couple games, I'm like, wow, really? All right.
What? Anyways, yeah, that's all I got. I'll leave it at this. I think the diversity of the scheduling this year was pretty good. I like it. You're getting a lot of mix between, at least in the 9-man classes, between 9B and 9AA. As far as going up into 11 and then class 11-man, I like the 11B schedules a lot. I think intertwining those with 11A is interesting, but I think it's okay, especially when, when you're mixing Bridgewater Emery's and Sioux Falls Christians together.
Right.
It's just a matter of skill level, and I think that skill gap is increasing, Cole. I really do, between 11A and 11B.
Well, it's a little bit of a – it's definitely skill gap too, but when you think about it and you look at it last year, like that West Central winter game, it was just a style gap.
Oh, for sure.
Like you think of these two teams, you think of the West Central winter history and, oh, we're tough-nosed football, we're going to run it the whole time, and it was just a completely – it's – like a shift once you get, kind of above nine man and 11B, I think is just hard nosed. We're going to run the football for 90%
of
teams. And you look below that and you look above that, it's like it's more college style, pro style offense with a lot more passing mixed in.
You know what? I want to talk about something just for 30 seconds, okay? The last 2 years in 11B, the teams who've won it in respect to Elk Point, Jefferson, and Hot Springs. They could run the ball, but they passed too, Cole.
Yeah.
They passed a lot more than the usual 11B team.
Right. It wasn't just like a pass to take the top off the defense and try to get you back up a little
bit.
It was consistently incorporating in it when...
Like Elk Point's quarterback was a dude.
Yeah, like when you didn't expect it. Like they're lining up with this power formation again, all of a sudden it's play action and seven guys go out. Mm-hmm. I mean, not literally, but, it's just, wow, all right.
Elk Point played with a true tight end the last 2 years in a row. Hot Springs had the best running back 11B seen since probably 2017, 2018, somewhere in there, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It just a flat-out different game than when we played it, and it's only been 2-3 years, Cole.
Yeah, it is. And that's just the way it is.
That is. Cole?
That's just the way she goes. We better take a break. We're only 10 minutes late. No big deal.
We're actually doing pretty good, I think.
Yeah, we're fine. We'll breeze through this draft. And I don't think either of us have picks for the week, so this is going to be the final segment as the draft coming up. Again, top five jersey combos with a couple special guests. That's going to be on the way next on the CharCole Sports Show here on KAOR.
Welcome back to the 28th edition of the CharCole Sports Show. I'm Charlie Prien, joined by Cole Larsch. We have some special guests, Cole. In the studio now is Morgan Benzo and Brianne Rendell. the legal name for Bree. How are you guys doing today?
We're good. Great.
Great.
That's what we like to hear.
So the reason they're in the studio today is because of a really darn good bracket by Morgan Benzo. Bree had a really good one, too. I don't want to discount Bree, but the really good bracket challenge that got him in here, and they got to pick a draft segment of sorts, and this is where we're at.
If we're going off the order and how we finished in the bracket challenge, shouldn't I leave because I was so bad?
Well, I shouldn't even be here either. I mean, we should just let them run the show.
I was fifth to last. You were at least in the middle of the pack.
Okay, I took a shot in the dark in my winner, and they got beat in the first round.
Me too, but mine got beat in the second round.
All right. Looking forward to talking some NFL jersey combinations here. We'll do our top five draft. I kind of made a document for them. I didn't tell you this, Cole. I made a document for them. I'll have to pull it up here for you. It's kind of cool. But I took my top 20 that I made, and then I put it in a random order, and then I put pictures next to it so then they could really have an idea of everything. So this is what I did, Cole. I have the Commanders all black and the pictures of the Dolphins whiteout throwback. As everything is in a random order from what my favorite ones are. But
yeah.
But, yeah.
We got a lot of similar jerseys there, Charles.
No, it's all right.
I got one that I know, I guarantee neither of you three are going to have.
That's all right. So, we did say current. Do you have currents?
Oh, I have all kinds of them.
Oh, okay.
I have all kinds.
Well.
That's right.
It's all right.
Hey, no big deal.
I don't
listen
current.
Very well.
No, it's fine.
I can change it quick. I got, four current ones on here, too.
Okay, good.
Yeah, whatever. We'll just roll with it.
All right. Well, Morgan, you get the first pick of the draft, followed by Bree, and then it'll be myself and Cole. And yeah, let's get into it with the first pick in the top five jersey combination draft in the NFL. Morgan Benzo, you are now on the clock.
My first pick is the Bengals all white.
So Morgan goes with the Bengals white out uniforms. And I do think those are very clean. They brought them forward this year. It's the white helmet with the Bengal kind of, I don't know, lines or whatever on the helmet. It's a really clean look.
I think Joe Burrow looks great in them.
Is that so? Did you like the picture that I put on the document for you? I made sure it was Joe.
Yeah.
All righty.
I don't mind the pick.
I don't mind the pick either. I respect it. So now with the second pick, Bree, you're up, and you cannot take, obviously, the Bengals whiteout anymore.
My first pick is the Seattle Seahawks action green outfit.
So,
neon one?
Yes. Yeah, the neon greens are really clean. I've liked those for a long time. Are very iconic, though.
I
tried to find it in the document and put it on there for the girls, but I wanted them to see the Jamal Adams like armband with the full green on Jamal Adams with the visor, because that's clean.
Yeah, that was insane.
Really clean jersey there. So that's where our picks. You guys can. Grab the mic like this.
So far, are we 2 for 2 for Color Rush? Are the Seahawks green technically Color Rush or no?
They are Color Rush. The Bengals whiteouts are alternate, I think.
Okay, I
think
suppose.
Their Color Rush is. I don't even know. Yes, Morgan. You can talk whenever you want.
Hey, have at it.
I was just making faces.
Oh, okay.
We talk over each other all the time.
Absolutely.
This is gonna be fun.
My first pick and my favorite jersey combination is this year's Eagles Kelly Green alternates. I love them, man. They're my favorite jerseys. The helmets are so crispy, like that matte Kelly Green. It just gets me going. So that's my pick. And Larsh, you're up here at the 4.
No! You can't leave it for me and then get disappointed when I take it, man. Come on. I took the Vikings Color Rush from this year. I mean, they're just insane.
Color Rush from this year or the throwbacks from this year?
Oh, which one was
the Color Rush or the yellow numbers? The throwbacks or the white numbers with the or the purple numbers
outline.
Color Rush.
You want Color Rush?
Yep.
Okay.
The one I'm looking at right now, where it says NFL Color Rush with a picture of Kirk Cousins. R.I.P.
We usually play in those around Thanksgiving.
Yep. What? Can I see it? Yeah. Here's Kirk Cousins. Wait, nope. I know. Yeah, it's this one.
So if we're snaking,
are we snaking?
Are we? I don't care.
Outfits are so cute.
Or we can just go back to more.
Let's just go back. Okay. I set it up. Yeah.
We're not snaking. It'd be too confusing.
Right.
So now Morgan, the first pick in the second round of the Charcole Sports Show top five jersey combination. Morgan Benzo, what do you pick here?
I'm gonna do the Vikings throwback one.
The Vikings this year. So the Vikings throwback ones from this year feature a older Vikings purple. It's a little darker purple, if you will. And it's more of a matte helmet. Big white numbers, no Vikings name above the numbers as well, and yellow trim, white pants are pretty clean. Cole, we were there for the first time.
This was the game that we were at, yes.
Yeah, and I thought they were really clean. I wasn't a huge fan of the gray visors, though.
No.
I wasn't. I mean, that's the one thing I wish we could.
Honestly, that's why I picked the Color Rush over the throwbacks. I mean, I like them. I like them, all of them, because they're all Vikings. But
same. So, that's good. And if you have any, like, justification with your pick, you guys can say why you like it. I mean, say whatever.
I don't know. I really like the numbers, like the white with the yellow around them.
Like, they are big white numbers, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, with the second pick in the second round, Bree Rendell, what are you going to pick?
I'm going to do the Dallas Cowboys throwback uniform.
The Cowboys throwback uniform. Now, Bree, are you talking the white throwbacks or the navy blue throwbacks?
The navy blue throwbacks.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, those are nice.
Yep.
When I think that, I think Emmitt Smith.
Yeah,
so my pick now, I got to go back to my list. I don't want anybody to see my list. And I'm glad it's still there. It is. I want this year's Buccaneers light orange throwbacks. Those things are crispy. Let me get them up. I'm gonna show a picture to the whole studio.
Like the creamsicle ones?
Yeah, the creamsicle ones.
That was on my list.
Look at that.
Yeah, that was on my list.
I liked them
better now. I liked them better now than when they were they actually used them.
Right,
they looked a lot better.
I think a big part of that though is that Nike did a good job with making them more. I don't know what the word is, like fresh. I don't know. It just made more sense, if you will. I think they're nice. Cole, who do you got here?
Well, this one technically wasn't a current jersey.
Nah, that's fine.
However, they did it last year for a throwback. I'm going to do the Oilers throwback that the Texans did.
I had that on my list, actually. They did it this year, didn't they?
Yeah.
Tank Dell wore it.
Yeah, and the NFL told them they couldn't do it anymore.
Right.
Which and is then, stupid. So,
right.
Take it as you will, but.
And then SMU tried to do it, too, didn't they?
Yeah, something like that. And it was they had a big problem on their hands. And I say just let them wear it. Why not?
You guys know what that jersey looks like?
For some reason, whenever I think of old school NFL, the first thing that pops in my mind is the Houston Oilers. And I don't think they were ever the Houston Oilers in my lifetime.
No, they weren't.
And I don't know why. I always think of the Houston Oilers.
It's like a baby blue jersey, red trim on the white number, white helmets. It's pretty clean.
Yep.
Clean. All right, Morgan, you're back at the top here, round three.
Mine is the Panthers all black.
The Panthers all black.
With a little blue on it.
Look at this for the studio. This is the Panthers all black.
Yep.
It's a pretty nice jersey. I think they did a good job with the black helmet as well. And it really fits because there's no difference between their actual home unis. Like, those are their color rushes, but with black pants, which are their away pants. So they just combined a color rush black jersey with their away black pants, and then it's got a black helmet because you know what, we can. Also, I saw this week, Cole, and girls in the studio, that next year the NFL teams are going to be allowed to have three different helmet combinations.
No way.
Yeah. So
I mean, this might be a little tangential here, but why are they so restrictive on it? I get it. You want all of them to be the same. Why don't you give teams creativity?
I will bet you $500 that is Roger Goodell just being like, no, it's never been that way. It's never going to be that way. No.
Probably. Yeah, I think so. That's probably it. But wouldn't you think, like, merch sales, wouldn't you want everybody to buy all the different jerseys?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And a lot of people would?
That's true. But, yeah, I don't know.
That's more money.
For sure.
Yeah, I just don't get it. I don't get that part of it, I guess, but.
Pick two of the third round. We're moving in a pretty good clip here, Cole. I'd say three, you're up.
I'm going to choose the New York Jets stealth black uniforms.
The Jets Stealth Black, which is a black helmet, which is a black chrome helmet, not a black matte helmet. It looks really clean. This is for everybody in the studio that wants to see. It's a shiny black helmet with a black jersey, black pants, green socks. Really nice. I'm a big fan. And when they released those, I was like, oh my gosh, when Rodgers plays in that. And then obviously everybody knows what happened to Aaron Rodgers. But those are clean. I like them. Good pick, Bree.
I love the green. It matches my bag.
Now I gotta look down my list here. Holy buckets. I have on my list now the Colts black helmet, blue jerseys, and pants. It'll make sense when I show you it, but it's like pretty much the Colts blackout. This is what, or no, it's not. It's the Colts blue out. It's a black helmet, which I don't think makes sense, and a blue uniform. If they did a blue helmet, it'd be clean. But it's a blue uniform with white numbers and black trim and a black helmet. I really like that. That jersey is really clean. Cole, here we go.
I'm torn between two here. Hang on. Let me see. Because I'm trying to see. A lot of these were current. And I just have to confirm that they are current. I believe they are. Okay. So I'm going to go with the Panthers baby blue alternates here.
Yo, yeah, those are clean.
I like them a lot. Baby blue alternates. I have a lot of, you know, you're seeing a lot of times on these lists is there's a lot of alternates and there's a lot of color rush.
Yeah, I don't have many base unis on here. And we could for sure do a base unis draft, which that's kind of boring.
Right.
I think the Packers should be last. And
a lot of people have them first.
Right.
But I just don't.
Those things are ugly. Like their original alternate uniforms of like 5 years ago, those things are ugly. I want to show them to the girls.
I agree with you.
2015 Packers alternates. I cannot wait for them to laugh at this. This is what they looked like. Look at that.
Why is there a circle on
I
them?
Don't know.
Yeah.
Why are they blue?
Wait, isn't...
Yeah, it is. Wait, it is. It is a little bit of a blue. It's because they changed to green after some point. But yeah, I don't know. Okay. They're gross. And you could play with them in Madden, and for some reason, it was always the free jersey you got before you could pick your jerseys in Madden. Cole, like that's OG.
Yeah, that is.
So, anyways, we got 10 minutes left in the show. We got 2 rounds to go. We're doing pretty good.
Yeah,
here.
Piece of cake.
We'll talk about our standings from last week, and we'll just kind of throw it out the window. But anyways, fourth round, the first pick in the fourth round, Morgan Benzo, you select.
I'm going to do the Lions throwback one, but I kind of like the pants more than the jersey. I like the pants with the jersey because they're like silver.
Let me get it up here. Okay. Yes, I agree.
That's not the one I was
Oh, I need to look up Lions alternate, my bad. This one, the grays. So yeah, it's their new helmet.
I know, it was gray.
It's their new helmet. It's got a blue helmet and a gray uni. It's pretty clean. White numbers, which is terrible for TV.
I love that.
A gray jersey on white numbers.
Yeah.
With barely any blue trim.
Yeah.
Like, huh?
I like it.
Looks but, cool in person.
No.
You just don't have very good taste.
I don't want to be fans of any other team besides the Vikings, at least in our division. That's why I don't have any other divisions on here, like of Vikings division teams. I don't have any Bears. Actually, I do have a Bears on here, but it's late. I don't think it'll get picked.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So yeah, if all 19 options get chosen, then I'm going to take this as my 20.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, pretty much.
With the second pick in the fourth round, Bree Rendell, you select.
Well, as a Vikings fan, this is going to hurt, but I choose the Green Bay Packers throwback uniforms.
Why?
I like the green.
Oh, like this year's throwbacks?
Yeah, like the all green.
Oh, okay, yeah, those are fine. Yes.
I like this one.
Yeah.
This is the only outfit that I can go for the Green Bay Packers.
Well, I don't know if we're drafting outfits or jerseys, Bree.
Outfits. Sorry.
No,
the
it's
outfits
all right.
are better.
But yeah. Those are some okay jerseys, and I probably put them on there if I was any other team's fan. But like it's like a highlight yellow. I like that. And the green's a little different shade. It's definitely better than their old throwbacks.
Can I just say they need more pink jerseys? There's no pink jerseys.
That is a factual statement.
Is there?
They
reason?
Have pink towels in October.
Mm-hmm.
That's because
and
of
pink
cancer.
Socks and
yeah,
pink
well,
armbands.
They should
stuff.
Make pink ones.
I don't think that'll happen.
I doubt it will.
I don't think that'll ever happen.
I think the only time we got close to that was when the Giants way back in the day had red jerseys, like all red jerseys.
Right, and the Buccaneers got close with their really faded colors.
Yeah,
always.
Right.
But, yeah.
I think that's the only time we've ever gotten close to that. All right, Charlie, fourth round to you.
I got
to
go down the list. Oh, easy pick. My fourth round pick, I'm taking the Browns whiteouts. Look at this, everybody. Let me get it up. I mean, look at this. You just imagine David Njoku, okay? Look at this. David Njoku just staring at you in an all-white uni. Clean, by the way. Love it. Browns unis. I'm loving my draft right now, man. My draft is great.
Yeah, I agree.
Larsh, get it.
Here's the deal. I don't know if this one's current, but it's. I don't know if it's current, but it's recent. Here we go, all right? The Chargers jerseys with the blue tops or the white tops, either one, and the yellow pants. Not the white pants. Chargers home and away jerseys with yellow pants.
Mm. Oh, you're talking. Okay. Like what? Like how dark of a, like what? How? What shade of blue?
Not the.
This is their current alternate this year. This was what they wore last year. It's like the OG LaDainian
Tomlinson. No, that's like the San Diego. Nope, that's like the San Diego Charger
right.
blue. No, the lighter blue, like this. Like, hang on, please hold. One of us.
Like their normal home unis, but with yellow. Oh, here it is.
Yes, the home. Yep. Yes, these right here.
Yes, that's what I was trying to show you.
There we
yeah.
go. Yep. These home unis with yellow pants.
Yes, those are clean.
Yep, I like them a lot.
I think what they did going from, no offense to San Diego, and I love when they're the San Diego Chargers, but changing from that really horrible color of blue to this lighter blue is just so much more welcoming. It's too bad they don't have a fan base.
That's true. I think it also signaled like they're trying to like fully change from San Diego to Los Angeles with the color change.
I think so too. Yeah, this is our last round in the draft. Morgan, your last pick in the draft, if you hopefully have a team left, well, who's your last pick in the Charcole Sports Show top five jersey combinations in the NFL draft?
I'm going with just the plain Bengals home jerseys.
So the plain Bengals home unis. Now, the Bengals, like their, like, are you talking about their black on blacks?
Yeah. No.
Or are you talking about their white on blacks?
The black.
Okay. So.
Just like the orange. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like the jersey you, I got you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I did buy her a Joe Burrow jersey for Christmas. I don't know if I told you that.
You probably did.
But pretty wild. Anyways, those jerseys are nice. And the thing is, you mentioned home unis. I think last year the Bengals wore their alternates and away jerseys at home more often than they actually wore their blacks.
Yeah, I think so too.
Because they liked their whites so much. But yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Well, I like all of them.
Pretty wild. Bree, who do you got here in your last pick?
I don't know if this is like a current one.
It is. I saw it.
The New York Giants, like their 1980s, 1990s look. It has like the bright blue jersey with the black helmet.
It's clean.
Cole, what was that look for?
I was just looking to see what it was.
Do you not like it?
You ever heard of Lawrence Taylor?
No.
He sported that uni and he was good.
Yeah, he did.
I think it's pretty sick. I like the helmet with the red stripe down the middle. You can see their head spot when they run.
Yeah. that's a good pick there. I do like that. It's respectable. Now I got to go down my list and pick my last one.
Yeah, I got to find my last one, too.
I think I know what I got. I know who I want. I had the Browns whiteouts on here. I picked that. Bree took the Seahawks neon green, so I can't pick that. I'm going to settle. Uh-huh. I'm going to settle here. And I'm liking my pick. And, you know, you always pick the best player available, Cole. Right?
Yep.
Unless you're Rick Spielman. Laugh, girls.
That's true.
Ha, ha, ha.
So.
True.
Here's my pick. This year's Broncos orange alternates. It's a lighter orange with a navy blue helmet, which is an alternate. It's a throwback helmet on a very modern jersey. Notice that Dalton Reisner is in the background of that picture. Blocking. But
is that why you chose that picture?
No.
Oh.
I actually didn't notice that until just now. But we don't even know if he'll be a Viking next year yet. We'll see how the draft goes. But
I will be going to their stadium in the summer.
Who? The Vikings?
No, the Broncos. Stadium.
The Broncos, Mile High, huh?
Yep.
Yeah, you'll be going to Mile High Stadium at something. It renamed, didn't it, Cole? I believe it did.
Yeah, I think it did.
But Denver, a very interesting franchise. They have to pick a quarterback position as well, assumably, in next week's draft, so... Cole, that rounds it out for me. It's the last pick here in the draft, and we are actually semi on time.
Yeah, we are. Tavin's trying to look over your shoulder at all the jerseys we've taken. I don't know if he's been listening or not here, but...
I have Chicago one or something.
I don't remember if this is the home or road uniform, so I'm just going to pick both of them technically. The Ravens, home-road combo.
Yeah.
The Ravens at my fifth and final pick. I'm just going to put Ravens. I don't remember if it was their home jersey or their away jersey.
Look at these. I have it on my list.
Yes. Yes. For sure.
Describe it for the crowd.
That is a steal at the fifth pick.
That is a steal.
Oh, I was going to do that one, too.
They're clean.
Love it.
If they had any decent alternate like helmets, man, they could go purple on purple and everything. But
yeah. I don't know what he's saying back there. He's... Italiano, something. I don't know what he's doing.
But yeah, that rounds
you
it
have,
up.
Do you want any honorable mentions?
I could roll through so quick, but I don't got much to say. I had...
my honorable mention was going to be like the old school St. Louis Rams from like the late 90s and early 2000s.
I have the Dolphins whiteout throwbacks of this year. I also... You go ahead.
Yeah, not
I
bad.
I have that one, too.
I also have the current 49ers white throwbacks with that, like, black shadow on the numbers. I like those a lot. I'm a huge fan of those. And then the Raiders whiteout with the silver helmets. I just found a cool picture of Josh Jacobs.
There was a lot. Like, everywhere I looked, ranked one of the Raiders as one of the top. Like,
yeah.
It's just a basic-looking jersey. Like, there's nothing special to it. I just don't – nothing really – I mean
– That's not a bad
– I don't mind it.
That's not a bad picture, though.
Yeah, right. I liked – honestly, I liked the Raiders jerseys back when they were in Oakland.
Yeah, same.
Too bad nobody
– They modernized.
Bad, yeah, too bad nobody cares about sports in Oakland.
No kid. Well, that rounds out the show. Girls, do you have anything else to say? This will be the last time you're on the show for a while, unless you call in.
Thanks for having us.
You're welcome. Thanks for taking part in our bracket challenge.
I love it. Can we be a part of this again?
Yes. You can
and
come back.
We'll take that to the committee
okay.
to decide. We
Thank
got
you.
It. It's 7 o'clock.
Yeah, we
got to
go.
CharCole Sports Show, 6 o'clock every Wednesday. Podcastable, Spotify, Apple. Please go quickly.
Next Thursday, again, our draft show will be live on YouTube. Find us on the CharCole Pod is what it's called. But, yeah, the CharCole Sports
we'll
Show.
We'll send the link out about 1,800 times.
Exactly. All right. Well, that's all I got. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in to the CharCole Sports Show, KAOR. In Vermilion, the nosebleeds are next.
Time for you to go out to the places you will be from. Closing time. This room won't be open till your brothers or your sisters come. So gather up your jackets, move it to the exits. I hope found a friend. Closing time. Every new beginning comes from summer.